Hello and welcome back to another episode of the Medical Minute. Today we'll be discussing antihypertensives. Antihypertensives are a class of drugs used to treat hypertension. Hypertension, commonly known as high blood pressure, is a condition in which the force exerted on the vessel walls by the blood is consistently elevated. We may dive into this disease in more detail in a future medical minute, but this constant elevation in blood pressure weakens the vessel walls and can cause damage to the organs of the body. The goal of antihypertensive medication is to bring the blood pressure down and to keep it down. To understand how these medications work, let's do a quick basic review of how blood pressure is controlled by the body. Imagine the circulatory system as a closed loop of pipes that are filled with a certain volume of fluid and connected to a pump. In this analogy, the pipes are the blood vessels, the pump is the heart, and the volume of water is the volume of blood. The first way to increase blood pressure would be to increase the rate and the force of the heart's contractions. In our analogy, this would equate to turning up the strength and speed of our system's pump. Another way to increase blood pressure would be to constrict the blood vessels. In our analogy, this would be similar to swapping the existing pipes out for narrower pipes. Remember that the system is closed, so decreasing the available space while the volume of fluid remains constant would cause an increase in pressure. The last method for increasing blood pressure would be to increase the volume of blood in circulation. This is the same principle as the previous example, but flipped. We're increasing the fluid volume within a closed space. With a general understanding under our belt, let's switch gears back to our antihypertensives. There are many antihypertensive drugs available to help lower our blood pressure, and each class approaches hypertension differently by blocking one or more of the pathways we've just discussed. Each drug is specific for the individual conditions of the patient, so what works for one patient may not necessarily work for another. First, we have alpha blockers. These drugs prevent vasoconstriction, which is the narrowing of the blood vessels, and ultimately decrease blood pressure. Examples of alpha blockers include doxycycline and prazosin. Next, we have beta blockers. Selective beta blockers, such as atenolol and metoprolol, act on the heart, decreasing blood pressure by decreasing the rate and force of the heartbeats. Non-selective beta blockers, such as labetalol and carvedilol, provide the same effects of selective beta blockers, but also work to dilate the blood vessels and reduce the blood volume by telling the kidneys to produce more urine. Another major class is calcium channel blockers. The movement of calcium across cell membranes of muscular tissue is needed for contraction, so these drugs affect both the heart and the smooth muscles of the blood vessels. Amlodipine and diltiazem are two examples of calcium channel blockers. Our next major class is diuretics. Diuretics, sometimes called water pills, are medications that cause the kidneys to produce more urine. This decreases the available volume of blood in circulation, therefore decreasing blood pressure. Common diuretics include furosemide and hydrochlorothiazide, commonly abbreviated as HTZ. Angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, better known as ACE inhibitors, such as lisinopril and benazepril, and angiotensin II receptor blockers such as losartan, both result in the relaxation of smooth muscle in the vessels and increased fluid output by the kidneys, therefore reducing blood pressure. They achieve this effect by inhibiting different areas of the renin-angiotensin pathway, but we won't have time to review this in today's video. The takeaway: there are a lot of ways to approach hypertension. Since hypertension can be caused by a problem in one or more pathways, one or more antihypertensives may be prescribed at any given time. I hope that this video will help you recognize and identify antihypertensives when documenting on patients with hypertension. Thank you for joining me this week. Let me know what you thought of our brief summary of antihypertensives by leaving a comment below. Have you ever found yourself wondering what the differences between a VQ scan and a CT of the chest are? Join me next time for a comparison of these diagnostic imaging studies. And for more updates like these, come join us online